right. So Tamas, he's at Oakland University, and he's also a long-time MFEM user, and in particular, he's been working on this hybridized DG branch, and he's going to tell us about it. So Tamas, please take it away.
Thank you for the introduction. Just let me confirm that you can hear me and see me correctly.
Yeah.
Excellent. So I want to talk about the HDG branch that we started to develop a long time ago. So it's going to be slightly a different talk. I don't have nice videos. I already showed those at the FEM at LLNL series. So this is a little bit more technical, but not too much. There are a couple of parts of this talk. So first, I want to talk about the initial version, how we started this HDG branch. Then a couple of words about some updates that happened, some actually quite recently, and some applications and future work with this branch. So first and foremost, I'd like to say thank you for a couple of people. This entire branch started when I was working with Sander Rebergen at University of Waterloo. I was the postdoc of the group, and there were two PhD students, Abdullah Galisivas and Gisela Sosa-Jones, who also used the function, used the approach that we did and gave me some useful feedbacks. And then last summer, 2022 summer, I spent some time with Tambu Tan and Xiaowei Chen at Texas, and I had to do something with this branch, and I realized that I can make it much more flexible. So that was a good step forward, getting it closer to something that I'm willing to submit as something to review. But the last step happened recently when I was working with Natasha Sharma and Gisela Sosa-Jones, who in the meantime became my colleague at Oakland. So that was the last addition that I needed, and now I feel like the branch is something I can show to people. So initially, we added two examples and a new bilinear form and a couple of integrators. The two examples we added were diffusion problem and an advection reaction problem. So the diffusion problem is based on this paper down in the footnote. You start with a simple Laplacian, basically, you rewrite it to a first order system, and you derive a weak form, multiply the first equation with a vector valued test function, the second with a scalar valued test function, and do some integration by parts. And you introduce this third variable here, this lambda h, as the trace variable. So it's something that lives on the skeleton of the mesh. So that's coming from the space M. V and W are your standard DG spaces on the elements. One is vector valued, the other is scalar valued, and then this space M is a DG space on the skeleton of the mesh. And for the second equation, you have, again, the lambda and the penalty parameter, because for the vector valued part, you introduce a flux as Q plus tau times U minus lambda. So you have a penalty parameter or stability parameter. And since you have a new variable, you need a new equation. So that's the third equation where you guarantee the continuity of the flux in the normal direction. So I have a couple of notations in these slides, standard L2 inner product in dimension D, and then standard L2 product in dimension D minus one, where you can do the integrals in two different ways. You can either sum over all the elements and integrate on the boundary, or sum over all the faces. So that's why in this third equation, I have sum over all the faces that leads you to some jump terms. So this is the discretization for the diffusion problem. And the other example that we added is an advection reaction problem based on this 2011 paper. So again, you have your simple differential equation. It's an advection reaction problem. You multiply with the test function, do integration by parts, and do an upwind flux. That's why we have here the outflow and the inflow of an element separated. But again, on the boundary, I define this lambda. Again, same as in the previous slide, it's the skeletal variable that lives on the interface of the mesh, not inside the elements. So again, you have a second equation, which is the continuity of the flux. So in both of these cases, we have degrees of freedom that live inside the elements and degrees of freedom that live on the skeleton of the element. So if you write it as a matrix form, you can write it as a block system. U is all the unknowns, all the unknown coefficients for the volume unknowns. Lambda is all the unknown coefficients for the skeletal variables. You have a matrix system. And for first time in your life in a finite element calculation, you can actually write A inverse here and literally mean the inverse of the ginormous matrix A, because A is block diagonal. So I can calculate A inverse very easily. I can substitute it, I can use that to express U from the first equation and substitute into the second one. And in the end, all I have to solve is this Schur complement problem. That's the only equation I really need to solve. The volume unknowns after that, I can retrieve with a reconstruction step. Now, one little thing that's hidden on this slide, the matrices A, B, C, and D themselves can be block diagonal. Just think about the diffusion case I showed you a couple of slides ago. Inside the element, we had the unknown function U and its derivative Q. So you had already A as a 2x2 block matrix, meaning that B and C were also block matrices. So the algebra can be a little bit messy if you work it like that. I prefer this style. And in the regular DG assembly, what do? We loop over all the elements, calculate certain volume integrals, and loop over all the faces and calculate certain face integrals. And if it's an interior face, add the contribution to the two neighboring elements. So the nice part is that we loop over the faces only once, because we do separate the loop over the elements and the loop over the faces. Now, if I want to look at the HDG assembly, I have to do it slightly different if I want to be smart and quick. You loop over all the elements and calculate the volume integrals. So far, it's the same as the DG, but then you loop over the faces of the given element and calculate the face integrals that may show up in all four of those matrices in the previous page. Then after that, since you calculated the volume and the face integrals for A, you can invert A locally, do some boundary elimination if you need to, and then you can calculate the Schur complement locally on one single element. And then you can move on to the next element and so on. The advantage is this, that we can calculate the Schur complement locally. The disadvantage is that you are looping over the interior faces twice, once on each neighboring elements. And then there is another part of the HDG calculation, the reconstruction. So once you have the skeleton solution, you can get the volume unknowns. Then the loop looks very similar. Calculate the volume integrals, loop over the faces, calculate the face integrals. You only need two out of the four matrices for the reconstruction. Invert A locally and do the reconstruction again locally. So that's very quick. And I have the same red line here, because same issue shows up, that you are looping over the interior faces twice. To make it a little bit less painful to wait for the assembly to finish in the initial version of the HDG branch, I had a possibility to store A and B on some elements or on all elements during the assembly process. And during the reconstruction, you don't need to recalculate them. You can just load them and get the reconstruction without calculating integrals. And that brings me to discuss a little bit about the volume and the phase integrals. So we did something maybe unorthodox against the MFEM approach. We used one-shot integrators. That's how I like to call them. So they are problem-specific, and in one integrator, we calculate every integral that shows up in the local matrix A for the volume terms. So for the diffusion problem, we have a block diagonal system. I'll show it again in the next slide. We calculate every integral that shows up all at once. Most of these integrators are just standard MFEM integrators that show up in the volume term. And because we are using this problem-specific integrator, we forget about the modular approach of MFEM. It could be done differently. We could reuse the MFEM integrators, but that would require a little bit of bookkeeping. You calculate an integrator, which submatrix of A do you add it to? And of course, for the advection problem, it's not a big issue, because A was not a block matrix. For the diffusion, again, you can say it's not a big deal. It's a 2x2 matrix, it's easy to keep track. But later, when you get to more complicated problems, the bookkeeping gets horrible. So if you look at the bilinear form for that diffusion problem, there are three volume integrators that we need to calculate. And technically, actually just two, because two of them are transposes of each other. So you loop over all the integration points, calculate shape values, D-shape values, very standard MFEM approach. And basically, this term here is a vector mass integrator. And this term here is a vector divergence integrator. And this term here is a transpose of that. And then once you calculated those, you just put them into the three submatrices of A. For the phase integrals, we again have one-shot integrators that calculate all the phase-related integrals in one integrator and add it to A, B, C, D. Now, the skeletal unknowns, so there are some integrals that are related to skeletal unknowns. They are not, let's say, standard MFEM integrators, like in the volume integrator, we had to work a little bit. And also, there is another issue with the approach that we are doing, that we go over the element and then the element's boundary, and then go to the neighboring element and go through the neighboring element's boundary, because the normal of an edge is calculated such that it's an outward normal for the element one of the phase element transformations and an inward normal for the second one, for LM2. So we need to keep that in mind. And if we are an LM2, we need to multiply that normal with negative one, because locally we always need an outward normal. That we didn't find a better way to do it than carry a little Boolean in all of our phase integrators, which is called LM1 or 2. And it's exactly what it says. It tells you whether you are on LM1 or on LM2. Do you have to multiply the normal with negative one, or do you not have to? And again, the same comments as before. We dropped the modular approach. We could do that, but bookkeeping. So if you look at the diffusion problem, we have six integrals involving phases. But actually, this one and this one are transpose of each other. This one and this one is transpose of each other. So we actually only need to calculate four integrators. So the loop looks similar to a standard MFEM integrator. You have to calculate shape values and D-shape values, but also the facet shape values for the lambda terms, and lambda and nu terms here. And then we could take ideas from regular MFEM integrators. Basically, this guy here looks like a mass integrator for phases. This one here looks like a mass integrator on phases using skeleton unknowns. This one looks very similar to the normal trace jump integrator of MFEM, so you can call it normal skeleton trace jump integrator. And then this one here is just a weird mixed skeleton mass integrator, and one of the term is from the volume, one is from the facet. But you can calculate all of these in one single shot of integrators and add them to the corresponding parts of your block system. So then, throughout the years, I did some updates, and the first initial version had a different bilinear form for the advection problem and for the diffusion problem. So the first modification a couple of years ago was when I created a bilinear form that can handle both. The secret was that I used arrays of finite element spaces, arrays of grid function. Basically, those arrays of finite element spaces were there to mimic the tensor product behavior of, for example, the volume finite element spaces for the diffusion. And to make it a little bit more user-friendly, this is the true approach that I'm using. I have an array of volume finite element spaces and another array of skeletal finite element spaces. For the diffusion and the advection, I could overload it with some nicer functions so that the user doesn't have to create those spaces, those arrays, makes it slightly easier. And the most recent update, I think I actually pushed it this morning, is when I got rid of the two separate functions of assemble and reconstruct and created one function that does both And that was what came out of the recent collaboration on Facebook freestyle. So that's when I got that working first. And I was like, I need to put it into the branch. And also quite recently after discussion with Sanyo, I turned that into a mini app. So now the files are no longer in the example folder, but in a mini app HDG folder. So the idea with this assemble reconstruct is that the beginning of the two functions were very similar. Loop over the elements, calculate the volume integral, loop over the faces, and calculate certain face integrals. For the reconstruction, we don't need all four, only two, but that's not a big deal. And then we need to invert A locally. And then there is an if we are doing the assembly. Calculate the sure complement, otherwise reconstruct. So now the code is more compact, nicer, not necessarily more user-friendly with the finite element spaces. It's a little bit complicated, and I know I need to add more documentation to it, but it's definitely more compact. And there is one little issue that I ran into many years ago, and that caused me a lot of headache. If you access a boundary face, you can access it two different ways. It can be a boundary face, or it can be an interior face. And you may get a different order of the degrees of freedom. So long, long time ago, I pushed an issue and I got a very nice answer that made me understand where this came from. So we have to be careful with our HDG integrator because we don't do the standard MFEM approach of interior face integrator and boundary face integrator. So inside the loop, we need to check if the boundary of an element is an interior face or a boundary face. And also when we try to eliminate the boundary condition, we have some grid function that we got by projecting an exact solution to the facet unknowns. Also in that projection, we need to distinguish between interior and boundary faces. And this slide is just about to brag of how many things we have used this branch for. So I gave long, long time ago a talk when I talked about space-time Navier-Stokes. So that is basically the same bilinear form. And of course, if we have the space-time Navier-Stokes, that means that we have the steady Navier-Stokes, which means that we have the steady Stokes problem, where you have two volume and two skeletal finite element spaces, velocity and pressure. Then 2022 summer in Texas, we worked on magnetohydrodynamics when you have six volume finite element spaces and four skeleton spaces. That's when I realized that we need to make the bilinear form more flexible because what we were doing before with 2+2 spaces, getting that working for 6+4 is very tedious. It's much easier to write it in a flexible way. And then recently we worked on phase field crystals with Natasha and Giselle, where we have seven volume spaces and three skeletal spaces. And once I had the updated bilinear form for the magnetohydrodynamics, using it for the phase field was very simple. A little comment that not all of these spaces are necessarily the same. If you just think about Navier-Stokes, velocity and pressure, we need to use 1 degree lower for the pressure. Two skeletal spaces, but one of them is a discontinuous space on the skeleton, so an HDG space, but the other contains continuous skeletal functions, so that's an EDG space. So we have to keep that also in mind that these are different spaces. What I needed to change between the different bilinear forms, of course, the integrators, but that's another question. The boundary elimination. The boundary elimination is always very painful, and you need to spend a little bit of time to figure that out. But that's basically the only difference between the different applications. And also, in some cases, you can calculate the inverse of A faster. You can realize that, oh, one of the block of A is a vector mass integrator, I can invert that very easily, and then I can invert A using that and a little bit of algebra faster than just saying A local.inverse. About the future of the branch, in this recent update, I dropped the possibility to save A and B during the assembly and use it during the reconstruction. I do want to give that back. And I had a little bit of an issue with Patsy when I used 3.20, but when I used 3.18.6, I had no problem. So I might ask a question about that on the issue page. And things that I'm not particularly interested in doing, but maybe somebody is, you can get back to this modular approach, reusable integrators. But the bookkeeping, I found it way too tedious, and the code would be absolutely not user-friendly. But you would have the modularity. So it's up to you which one you want. And the other thing is that I am not using non-conforming meshes. I'm only using conforming meshes. Non-conforming meshes extended to that would be nice, but we never needed it, and ignorance is a bliss. I did not want to struggle with that, so we dropped that. But if anybody is interested, there is something you can work on. Thank you so much.
Okay, let me ask the obvious question. Go ahead.
Yeah, I'm interested in solving MHD, but I want to put those vectors in different finite element spaces, like edge curl, edge div. Do you think it better using hybridization?
So we haven't used edge div, edge curl elements. We only used basically the finite element spaces we are using are very similar to these. We have vector value DG spaces, scalar value DG spaces, and skeleton DG spaces, scalar or vector value. We have never used edge div or edge curl elements.
Yeah, so my question is it reasonable, easy to adapt that to edge curl, edge div for those?
You can try. We have never tried that. So I think it should be doable, but since we never needed it, I never worked on that.
Okay.
Yeah, I think it is possible, maybe with some slight modification.
But you say your implementation is not modular, right? So maybe there's there are many things I have to fix.
The biggest thing is that right now I'm using the fact that these spaces are the copies of scalar spaces. And in your case, you would actually have a d-dimensional finite element vector space. So that would be the biggest difference you would need to work. The rest would, I think, be relatively easy.
Okay.
There are other complications with edge curl, the traces and on-ground multipliers and weird spaces, and this sure complement system will become kind of like, well, anyway, we can talk about it. I think I'm interested to follow up on that, Chief.
Okay, sounds good.